nationally and internationally known scholars of church music to Baylor University. The Northcutt Lecture Series is made possible through an endowment given by LeGrand and Cassandra Northcutt of Longview. Both of the Northcutts are Baylor graduates, and they are valued friends of the School of Music. The Northcutts are here today, and we would like for them to stand and be recognized. Ruth Duck is professor of worship at Garrett-Evangelical Theological Seminary, where she's been on the faculty since 1989. Her many books and articles about Christian worship include Gender in the Name of God, The Trinitarian Baptismal Formula, Finding Words for Worship, and with Patricia Wilson Kastner, Praising God, The Trinity, Christian Worship. Additionally, she has edited or co-edited three books of worship resources. Her most recent publication, Worship for the Whole People of God, Vital Worship for the 21st Century, published in 2013, is designed to serve seminary worship courses, pastors, and church leaders who seek to enrich their congregation's worship. Hymnals in several countries and many denominations include texts by Ruth Duck. The New Century Hymnal of the United Church of Christ, The Voices United of the United Church of Canada, and Glory to God, the Hymnal of the Presbyterian Church of the U.S., each includes 10 or more of her texts. She also has published three single author collections of her text, and a new collection of her text on the subject of grace is due for release later this year. In 2007, Dr. Duck served as president of the North American Academy of Liturgy, and in 2013, she was named a fellow of the Hymn Society in the United States and Canada. An ordained pastor in the United Church of Christ, Ruth Duck has served churches in Wisconsin and Massachusetts. She received her Doctor of Theology degree in Worship and Theology from Boston University's School of Theology in 1989. It is my pleasure to introduce you, to present to you, Dr. Ruth Duck, the 2015 Northcutt Lecturer.
Thank you. praise of psalms and other scripture passages has been a part of my work in congregational song from the beginning. At this point, I have paraphrased about 28 psalms. Since Emily Brink of the Calvin Institute asked me to talk about my setting of the psalms at the meeting last year, I have been doing a little bit more speaking about the psalms and my work on them. But this is the first time I've done a full lecture. I appreciate Dr. Music for giving me free rein in my choice of topics. I find it interesting that my denomination, the United States, the United Church of Christ, and your Baptist traditions are both of the Calvinist heritage. And if I may say so, I think that we both feel rather ambivalent about that heritage. And so it's quite interesting that at a time when the singing of the Psalms is being revived, we are probably two of the churches in the United States who are the least interested in chanting or singing the Psalms. Meantime, the Reformed Church in America, the Christian Reformed Church, the Presbyterian Church U.S., even the United Methodists, along with Scottish Presbyterians and many more, are regaining the singing of the Psalms, and often more frequently, and also with more engaging styles of music. This is not so true in the United Church of Christ congregations, and I dare say most Baptist churches. Now, I didn't come here to try to convert you or tell you what to do, but I want to share my enthusiasm. That's what I want to do. Once I discovered metrical psalms, they won my heart, so much so that I have said that I would like to set them all in my lifetime. Well, I'm going to have to live quite a while longer to get there. Although not a psalm, Comfort Ye My People, one of the early melodies from the Genevan Psalter, demonstrates what metrical settings of scriptures can be. The song that we sang is based on Isaiah, and you may want to have it side by side with the scripture I'm going to read now. Isaiah 41:5. Comfort. I think the page is turning, so I'll wait a minute for you to find the page with comfort and comforting the people. It's the one that has music that we use first. Well, I'll go ahead. The passage in Scripture reads, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill will be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." So, how does the scriptural text compare with the hymn text? Each stanza of the hymn is set with the same rhythm, and rhymes appear either at the end or both the middle of each line. To accomplish this means that some things are added and some things are taken away from the text in Isaiah. For example, the idea of people mourning is not in the psalm, but in the psalm. And the image of Jerusalem serving a sentence does not appear in the hymn text. Metrical settings in rhythm and rhyme often enhance worship and faith. They make the words and melody more memorable. They make it possible to set the text to lively, culturally popular melodies, whether the dance style of the 16th century. That's sort of my imagination, but I think they must have danced to it, or it must have been light dance music, because they say it does rock. Or whether it's contemporary Christian music, which by the poet in rhythm and rhyme. Chanting the Psalms is particularly helpful in congregations that follow the lectionary and do a different song every week as part of their worship. Worshippers only need to learn the method of chant and a few chant tones to be able to sing the Psalms. Now I'm going to do something that I don't usually do, which is to sing just a little in public. So one gift God did not give me is singing for a large group of people. This is not, I've sometimes complained about it, but it's really not fair because God has blessed me in so many ways. But this is a setting of from Psalm 46. God is our rock, God is our refuge. Amen. Not really.
Yeah.
Some of the settings, such as the Scottish text, "The Lord's my shepherd, I shall not. My Lord's my shepherd, I will not want," were lovely, and others were awkward. Needless to say, the psalm singing tradition came with English-speaking Christians to this continent. The 1640 Bay Psalm Book of the New England Puritans was the first book printed in British North America. Its translations of scripture were quite literal. "The Lord to me a shepherd is, therefore want not, shall I." Now, what it loses in syntax, it gains in direct quoting of the scripture. The words are kind of reorganized, but they're all there. Arranging psalm text to sing while featuring a word-for-word literal translation is difficult to do well. Now, the people who did these paraphrases were clergy, and they were very well educated in Hebrew, and they knew how to translate it. But I keep wishing there had been some musicians around to help him with some of these pastors with the tunes. It might have been quite different. And to add to that, the songs were lined out so the leader would redo one phrase and people would repeat it. And sometimes that's wonderful, especially if you have someone like John Bell, you know, his leadership, so a really good song leader, that could be wonderful. But it could be deadly, and it could also make you completely lose the sense of melody because you're breaking it up rather than doing it as a rhythm. Well, Isaac Watts is my hero. In the early 18th century, he insisted that Christians sing the words of faith not only from the Psalms. I appreciate him, as I was telling, I think, David. Not only is he part of my heritage as having been a Congregationalist, but also he was someone who was an innovator. He kind of showed some things up. And he actually, it's not in my notes, but I'll tell a little story about him. He went home from church when he was a teenager, and he was complaining about how dreadful the Psalms were. And his father rather grumpily said, at least in my imagination, "Well, if you think they're so bad, then why don't you write Psalms?" And so then he did once a week for quite a long time, and he wrote a few hundred psalm paraphrases. Well, 200 hymns and psalm paraphrases. I don't know how that breaks down. So, a century later, most English-speaking Christians were singing Isaac Watts, if nothing else. They might not be singing psalms, or they might be singing his psalm paraphrases, which were Christianized. In other words, he took the words and applied them to people's experience of Christ. With strong melodies and better syntax than the Bay Psalm Book provided. This generated a widespread interest in congregational song by writers from Charles Wesley to Fanny Crosby. So much so that hymns, not psalms, were now the mainstay of churches. African Americans also discovered Watts' texts. Their own style of lining out, probably combining both African practices and the New England lining out, ornamented the repeated melody in their own distinctive way in a tradition variously called Dr. Watts' lining out or African American chant. And once again, I'm going to just venture out my little voice. I love the Lord who heard my cry, or something rather repetitive, but then people would say, "I love the Lord who heard my cry." Well, I don't know that I'm singing it like anybody sings it, but it's also true that this has many different forms and different melodies used. And I didn't ornament it and make it last as long as it would, but it gives you the feeling. And some people feel that it has a bit of a quality that would express some of the suffering and struggle that they were under, because it would be done slower than I did it also. Likewise, I don't agree with Calvin that we should sing only the Psalms and not hymns of contemporary making in Christian worship. But why would we want to keep singing them? Well, I'll give you some reasons and see if you can come up with another few. Don Saliers talks about worship as being a time when humans are at full stretch before God. In other words, we're there with our joy, sin, our reconciliation, our problems, our losses, and we can bring all of that to God. So that's one reason, because it can give us a chance to express our feelings in ways we sometimes don't do in church. Another reason why we should sing the Psalms is because as we learn the Psalms and make them our own, we begin to realize that God really does accept us as we are. You know, people express all kinds of feelings in the Psalms. And as you will see when I talk a little bit about how I do some settings, I don't always keep the hard parts in. But yet, one argument that Walter Brueggemann makes is that when, even in Psalm 137, when it talks about bashing babies against the rocks, that's the expression of an imprisoned or oppressed people that are feeling very, very limited in what they can do. Now they're being asked to sing the Lord's song in a foreign land. And so it's an expression of how they're feeling. It isn't a prescription for what they're going to do. And so sometimes just the ability to express feelings can be a healing thing for us and a growing thing for us. Another reason is the power of the images. Now, you can probably, let's see if we can even, you can, I like participatory things, but I'll start out and then you call out some other images from the song. So we'll start with Shepherd. What about going in weeping and coming out rejoicing, carrying the sheaves? What other powerful images can you think of in the Psalms? A tree beside the water.
Rock.
Showers of blessings.
Shelter.
Your word is a light unto my feet. Oh boy, I'd like to write some of that poetry with all those images. It's really powerful. And I think that our North American culture, especially among Caucasian people, that we don't tend to think with that kind of creativity and imagery. Now, if you get to know some Korean people, you'll find out everything can be expressed in images for them, at least my students at Garrett. So it's a wonderful opportunity to be enlivened with that sense of imagery. And then one more thing, and I think we were talking about it yesterday, but you know, what about the biblical testimony that Psalms are part of the life of faith, whether you think of Maundy Thursday, which is tomorrow in our celebration of the church year of remembrance, and then what about psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs? So we do pretty well with the hymns and spiritual songs, but do we sing the Psalms? Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. Well, I talked a little bit about my method. Oh, I was going to ask you for more ideas, though. But why else might we want to use the Psalms? I'm not fishing for anything in particular. We just might have an idea to add to mine.
I guess maybe from a more Calvinist point of view, you know, the scripture is perfect. Whereas anything that, the scripture is the perfect word of God, whereas anything that, you know, we may write or paraphrase is less perfect and therefore more ambiguous and could lead to maybe false prophecy through music. I'm not sure, it's just a thought.
So then there's Calvin's idea of as being part of the word of God, and for some of us who might have a slightly different theology, the Psalms are part of the whole history of our faith, and it's being connected with the communion of saints, if we count people in the Old Testament as such, that and sing what they sing. What they sing, we don't know quite how they were used, or they were used in a variety of ways, but it's there in our fundamental document, right? Yeah. Any other ideas why we might use it?
Practice your discipline of common prayer using song.
So there's something you hold in common.
Yeah.
You know, I was just saying the 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills, and it was part of the Episcopalian liturgy for a memorial service. But it was the the psalm that my mother-in-law wanted me to read to her again and again and again when she was, you know, on the journey into the next life. And so there is that kind of, it's not as prominent as it would have been, you know, in 19th century New England, let's say, but it's still a part of our heritage and our, the way we talk with each other. Part of how we receive it and experience it. In the same way, words and images we choose to highlight in a song can bring out its meaning. And that's a lot of what I end up doing, is highlighting particular words or images or ideas. I lift up key phrases and images in the song, using the best English syntax as I can, and as perfect rhymes as I can do, and meter, regular meter, so that present singers will be able to enter into its meaning. In Bible translation, this is called dynamic equivalence, which seeks to transfer the meanings so that they make sense in the culture where the translation is read, rather than to define word for word. So if we've been looking now for a while at Psalm 10, there's a back-to-back scripture thing, and I apologize, when I sent this to Dr. Music, I didn't realize it. One side is Psalm 107 and one is Psalm 10. And then, I've got to find out Psalm 2. So let's look at why stand so far away, my God, and then at Psalm 10. I'll give you a couple of hints to start with. The psalm in verse 9 says, still turning? Most of you found it. Okay. You want this psalm, and then you want this small print scripture thing. Okay, so the psalm says, the wicked lurk in secret like a lion in its covert. They lurk that they may seize the poor. They seize the poor and drag them off in their net. And then in what I said, the sort of condense that and pick out the main images was, they wait to pounce upon the weak as lions stalk their prey. I realized just in preparing that I should have said to pounce upon the poor, because that's what it says in Psalm 10, and also it alliterates with other words in there. I wrote this paraphrase, I was in a Central South America solidarity group, and before we were having a meeting, I got news of some assassinations in Salvador, and so I wrote it to take to the group. And so I had a real-life reference to this psalm, and part of what you have to do to be able to paraphrase a psalm is to be able to relate to it in terms of your experience or what you're hearing on the news or something like that. It'll be hard to kind of break out of that to find a fresh expression. Now Psalm 107 is in the same packet with why it stands so far away. And this I have called Give Thanks to God Who You Are Christ. I wrote it for the North American Academy of Liturgy because there's that first word that says, give thanks to the Lord for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, those whom he redeemed from trouble. And so that verse, even though I didn't quote it very closely, was the idea that if you're teaching people about worship, then who more than anybody else should be praising God, especially for help in trouble. And so the thing I did with this was to try to match up the different desperate situations in the psalm to things that I thought people could relate to now. And so if you look in section 2, the first one is a little bit more general, talking about how God delivers, and then group 2, I've labeled that, is people who've been in prison, they're in misery, and in irons, hard labor, they cry to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. And so, I'm not even sure that I agree with what I did with this, and this is where we go. No, honestly, I mean, I was trying to remember the name again, but he was there when I presented this at Calvin College, and somebody in that group there did a ministry in with people in prison, and so he was a little disappointed that I had made it a metaphor rather than literal. So that's where I may not have done the right thing. But in stanza three, then, if you've ever lived inside the prison of your womb and cried to God who broke your bonds and raised you from your tomb, then the idea was to let people relate to being imprisoned in different ways than literally being imprisoned. And then when I talk about the ship, where's that? That's in the fifth stanza. If you have felt your courage fail before a violent sea and cried to God who still destroyed me, the wild men flee, then in the congregation praise the God who heard your plea. And so we could, as Christians, resonate with the stilling of the storm, and we can take it literally if we had been on a ship, but we can take it more figuratively, because that's one of the metaphors we use for being in trouble, being overwhelmed by the waves. So that gives you some ideas here, just a little more. One thing I noticed when I was preparing was that an obvious thing that I do that I hadn't named before is that I summarize. Because Psalm 107 is much longer than most of us would sing, whatever the method was, if we were to sing all the words and ideas. And so part of what I do is to take the ideas and make a shorter text than is in Scripture. And I'm always looking for those vivid images. I don't want to take them down, I want to raise them up. And then I'm looking at theology. Another thing, we had an interesting conversation with one of the men at Calvin Institute, because I left out the phrase in Psalm 107 about people being sick because they've sinned. And we got into quite a conversation. He says, but it's there in the Bible. I said, well, if people are sick, and then they also have to bear the burden of people thinking that they're sick because they've sinned, I just don't think that's really helpful. And we can finally catch up. So, oh well, I guess I'm just a radical, but then he laughed and we were done and we moved on. But you know, these are pretty important questions. You know, how liberal are you? What do you leave out? What do you keep in? How do you present the Psalms so that people can learn from them? And as somebody said in the back, you know, I can experience all the feelings that go with them. So there's not a right answer to some of these questions. That's why I'm kind of putting them. I could have done this instead of that in front of you. So what I'd like us to do, I keep trying to, I did it at Calvin and then I did it a couple other times, but I haven't figured out how to do it in big groups. This is what I'm struggling with right now. But let's together just look at some of the, there's five different sections I had to the song that I lined out. So then you would work, you would do this, the scripture of the passage of scripture with group three, and then you would look and see what I did with it in thank God, praise God. Anyway, you've heard our cries. Is that okay? More or less? Okay. Just have a little time. That's my little Korean bell I got at the market. I think what we'll do, and I've got permission to go just a little bit longer than, is instead of having you report back, because that just gave you a chance to look and see what can be done, let's take about 5 minutes. You can ask questions about what you just did or about anything in general, and then we'll, but we have about 15 minutes, so we can, 7 minutes to question and answer, and then
I think it was interesting that sometimes in the scriptures the statement would be a question, and then it, in the paraphrase it would be a statement or in verse. Sometimes the subtle changes.
That's an interesting point, that sometimes you might need to change the structure so it's you either go from a statement to a question or the other way. Some advice from somebody that was in my class and found the gospel musician. And so I went and met with him, and I said, "Do you have any Jews that don't have texts?" And when I heard the prayerful, reflective nature of this particular tune, I was really moved to set something into it. So would you sing that? Did a jazz set.